Thank you all for coming. It's great to see you all, and I'm really happy to be here again to have this, our final presentation with Dan before he flies off overseas. Dan did one presentation here in Feb, and it was very well received. It covered all the theory behind the work that has been done to do with magnetic imploders, to do with fractal technology, and today he covers the more practical side of it and how it can be used and how it can be implemented. Dan's reputation worldwide is something to be bored at to some degree. You have to have a look on his website to see how many places he's visited, how many things he's been influential in setting up and getting happening. So I highly recommend that you have a look at his website and have a look at his material, because it does take quite a while to digest it all, but there's so much of it there, and there's so much validity in a lot of the information that you just have to sit down and actually pull your head together and go through it, because there's a whole lot of things to do with the phase conjugation response of atoms and how they can be used to make many, many things much more efficient and much more beneficial use. And Dan will explain a lot of that today as part of his presentation, I'm sure. So please, make Dan to welcome, and I'll hand him over to you.
So thank you very much. So nice to be here with Astro again today. Is our sound okay? Everybody all right? Can you hear me? So this is our last in the series of Australian lectures for this year. We've done perhaps 10 or 12, and we always find the Melbourne audience is one of the most sophisticated, particularly in the area of technology, which is wonderful. The enthusiasm here is has been led in part by Sergio of Astro and his wonderful partner Josephine, and Ian Haken is here, who has really spearheaded our hydrolysis and some nonlinear energy projects here with Climtech. And so we're grateful, particularly to the support people here in Melbourne. Thank you. So as you know, the website is goldenmean.info and fractalfield.com. And my email is danwinter@either one of those. And the subject of today's conversation, the title and topic. As you know, in this whole lecture series, we have been focused on this idea that fractality, phase conjugation, is the electric cause of all centripetal forces, gravity, life force, perception, bliss, and enlightenment. Yesterday we taught at the Tibetan Center how to measure enlightenment using implosive collapse, golden ratio, and brainwaves. Welcome, Marianne. Hi. So we have been dwelling on this theme for some time, that this geometry, this particular geometry of waves, is the essential mechanism of all self-organizing forces. Today, we're going to attempt to apply that concept to technologies. We're going to be describing how the implosive collapse is the source of energy and the source of technological solutions to many issues of our culture. Specifically, we're going to be applying this concept called implosive collapse. How do you gain energy during compression? That is the essential issue of the day, called implosive collapse, what Einstein called non-destructive charge collapse. So today, hopefully you will not only have a sense of what implosive collapse, that when waves converge at a center, how it is that you generate energy out of the process of compression, implosive collapse. If you understand a little bit about what that is, you will see how incredibly powerful that is applied to technology that revolutionizes our planet. And the example technologies that we're going to review where solutions lie in implosive collapse are hydrogen, how to burn water. Implosive collapse in water, implosion in water, solutions to energy and agriculture. We're going to talk about implosive collapse in brainwaves, in EEG, in neurofeedback, not just measuring bliss, but solutions to addiction attention deficit. We're going to speak of the hardware regarding that, heart tuner and bliss tuner. We're going to talk about implosive collapse applied to the stock market. Self-organization among all waves can be identified if you understand the geometry of implosive collapse, non-destructive compression, implosive damping. We're going to take a look at briefly at the Steorn device, which is an energy generation device, which is electrical from Ireland. And we're going to look at the oscilloscope plot, and we're going to call the principle implosive collapse. We're going to look at briefly at five different natural solutions to radioactivity. Natural solutions to radioactivity, five different technologies. The principle of each one is implosive collapse. Then we're going to look at radiating fertility for agriculture, things called the Tower of Power and conjugate circuits, and how radiating that corrected electric field creates amazing fertility in agriculture. The principle is implosive collapse causes charge distribution, which is the mechanism of fertility. And we may play with a few other technologies. The point is that we want to look at this fundamental principle of implosive collapse. How do you gain energy during compression? And see that if we understand the pure principle powerfully, that we're enabled to solve our culture's technological problems. In fact, we might list the last technology here. Implosive collapse as the solution to the solar wind, otherwise known as How to Survive the Rapture 101. So we're gonna deal with this fundamental issue of get fractal or get dead, or how do you absorb the energy of compression without heat? And the solution is fractality, and that produces implosive collapse. So that is a short outline of what we want to review today, actually. And to begin with, I would like to review the symmetry, the pure principle, the science, just very briefly. The other lectures we've done have gone into the science in some detail, so this will only be a short review. This is the core symmetry principle. I repeat, the core symmetry principle, that in each of all of the above cases where I have listed implosive collapse, the symmetry, the shape, is the same. So that when we said fractal phase conjugation is the cause of gravity and life force perception, this fractal phase conjugation, or implosive collapse, in every case has only one shape. So that if you understand this shape, you understand fusion, alchemy, black holes, and hydrogen. So I urge you to understand how this one shape works, because it is the solution to every mystery functionally. So here is the shape. Notice that as you view the cones of a vortex of charge or water or energy or voltage or light or sound or magnetism, if you view the waves as they would enter a dodecahedron, as they would enter this structure, we call it the Star Mother Kit. It was originally called the Lesser Maze in Theosophy. We believe this is the only possible three-dimensional fractal, because the stellation of dodeca, icosa, dodeca, icosa, is a three-dimensional fractal. And the XYZ value of every vertex is a simple power of the golden mean. So distance to center is golden ratio from every vertex, which is why this is the mechanism of superconductivity and fusion and palladium and platinum group metals and alchemy and all black holes. We thank Nassim Haramein for helping us prove that golden mean ratio is the reason black holes exist. The definition of the word chem is in chemistry and alchemy. So this geometry for waves to converge, those cones, that is the only geometry we're discussing today. There will be no other shape that we're discussing today, only that one. And that shape, that pathway for waves, is going to be the specific mechanism of every nonlinear technology, every solution, every insight we discuss today, all self-organization. We'll only be discussing that geometry. For example, the new equation that I wrote for hydrogen, Planck length times golden ratio predicting hydrogen radii, is new proof from me that this is the geometry of hydrogen, definitely. Additionally, I wrote an equation that Planck time times golden ratio predicted the key frequencies, not just of hydrogen, but Planck time times golden ratio predicts the duration of the Earth year and the Venus year, accurately, proving that time, like space, emerges from chaos only when it's fractal, which is to say centripetal. So this is the effective geometry of both time and space. We also know that the geometry of the universe, if we look at the arrangement of interstellar masses, is a dodecahedron. And the reason is because that's the only way that the universe can have gravity. We also know that this is the geometry of every living protein. So that is the shape we're discussing. And that pattern of waves, waves of compression, and we believe those waves arrive in a unified field, which means whether you call it sound, light, voltage, electricity, magnetism, the difference is only basically frequency, that it's all the same substance. That's what the unified field means. I'm going to call that substance charge, but you can call it ether or the quantum foam or the time-space continuum if you want to use the current fashionable language. But I choose to call that substance, which is compressible and behaves like a fluid of the unified field, I choose to call it charge, where plus and minus charge is a centripetal centrifugal difference between compression and rarefaction in that universal compressible medium of which everything is made. So, in physics, we know that if waves arrive in that geometry, in optics, they call it four-wave mixing, phase conjugation, and that is the first time that physics ever measured self-organization. That's commonly described in phase conjugate optics. The reason it's called conjugation of phases is beautiful because that's going to lead us to how and why that produces a centripetal force, where you gain inertia during compression called implosive collapse. So from this picture now, we need to learn or review why does this geometry create the implosive collapse of charge, which is key to every mystery, including the reason gravity exists, the reason color exists, the reason consciousness exists, the reason perception exists, the reason all self-organization exists, the reason all electronegativity exists. So first, and this is review because we have done this in other lectures, but first, to just look at how and why it is that that geometry creates a centripetal force. I'm going to turn off the lawnmower. Okay, so we're looking at what is the top and side view of that picture I call phase conjugation, which is therefore a top and side view of hydrogen, every living protein, DNA, the universe, palladium, and every technology I'm about to discuss. This is the top and side view. So the purpose of this exercise is to understand why it is that that geometry creates a centripetal force, implosive collapse, gain energy during compression, which then is the reason that gravity exists and consciousness. As those waves, whether it's sound or light or charge, as the waves approach center, they add and multiply recursively their wavelength, of course, that's called recursive heterodyning, recursive wave interference. And remember that they're meeting in the golden mean ratio. And just to review the basics here, the golden mean ratio is the only ratio in the universe that allows both adding and multiplying. That's the essential principle. So B
Because the waves meet in golden mean ratio, any two waves add and produce the next one, or any wave multiplied by the golden ratio produces the next one. 1.618 squared is 2.618, etc. So this progression, called an arithmetic and geometric progression, is called beauty. And it's the geometry of every living thing. But now we know the electrical reason why. The reason why is because that is the solution to all constructive wave interference. And the reason why it's the solution to constructive wave interference is because it allows waves to both add and multiply and make kids that don't fight. So that process of solving constructive wave interference is what Einstein and Nassim did not understand. And the proof is here, that if you recursively interfere a large number of waves in golden ratio, you produce maximum power output. Whereas if you interfere those waves in any other ratio, like powers of two, you have maximum destructive wave interference. So the new information here is golden ratio is the generalized solution to constructive wave interference. Once you know that, you have now solved Einstein's problem. Infinite compression, which he knew was the solution to the unified field. So producing that compression uses this geometry, the golden ratio geometry, for constructive interference, and does not use this cubic geometry, because that produces destructive interference. This is why a square edge is considered evil in feng shui in astrology, and the 90-degree angle called green of a photon is spit out by every living plant, because it's not phase contrary. Destructive wave interference. So, to finish our thought, here are those waves adding and multiplying by golden mean ratio. They're adding and multiplying their wavelength. But what few physicists know is that they're also adding and multiplying constructively, recursively, their wave velocity, the speed of the wave front. And that recursive constructive interference of the speed of the wave front produces acceleration, adding and multiplying the phase velocity, produces acceleration out of compression. That process is the reason that gravity exists, is the reason that consciousness exists and perception exists, and black holes exist, and the reason hydrogen exists. So that mechanism generates a centripetal force. If you understand that, we can have the rest of our conversation today. But if you don't understand that, you might as well go home. So here it is simply. When waves meet in this pattern, they add and multiply the speeds of the wave front. So some of the charge goes out through the center, through the speed of light, and that charge has been accelerated is called gravity. So do you see that we have every living protein is based on golden ratio and is making golden ratio wavelengths, and hydrogen is based on golden ratio wavelengths. So Einstein was aware that if he could model infinite compression, he would actually model non-destructive compression or constructive compression, and he would understand the universal unified field, the function of gravity. And what he missed was the same thing that Nassim Haramein missed, was that golden mean ratio is the generalized solution to constructive wave interference. It's a basic idea that when waves in golden ratio, they produce constructive interference. And that very, very basic information is something that physics has not acknowledged. And that is the tragedy of our age. It's one of the major tragedies of our age. Because that means in your physics class, there has been no conversation about the cause of self-organization, the cause of gravity, the cause of life. It's like your science teachers are walking around pretending we can tell you how to live, and we can tell you how to build culture, and we can tell you biology, and we can tell you architecture. And those scientists do not know the cause of life. They do not even know an electric field causes life, and they don't have a clue why an object falls to the ground. They don't know what causes any self-organization, and they're telling you how to live. I say you should object to that stupidity, actually. And it's not that I'm smart, honestly. It's that this planet has been an exemplar of some incredible stupidity. And the first thing you ask your biology teacher after you measure the voltage you get end to end from a pine cone or an egg is you measure the voltage that's causing life by being fractal. And the first question for your biology teacher is where did that voltage come from? If they know, they should get a paycheck. If they don't, they shouldn't. The same thing is true of your architect, as we say, is that if you can build a building that causes life, then you deserve a paycheck. If you can make a building to cause a seed to grow, then you should get paid as an architect. Otherwise, you need to find another profession. It's quite simple. So if your architect is building square metal buildings, which is the kind of capacitor that does the opposite of constructive wave interference, and you feel like marred inside those structures, so I carry on, I get too excited, and maybe I do get too excited, but I'm passionate about this, and I want to be clear and simple. And I don't want anyone to go home and say, today's lecture was complicated. It isn't. Is that complicated? Golden ratio cones of charge approach, and they create a centripetal force. And that's the reason you have perception. It's the reason you have gravity, and the reason you have life, and the reason you have hydrogen. It's very simple. Okay, so the way that creates life is in a pine cone, for example. The seeds are little dielectric capacitors, and you get a voltage difference from the top to bottom. And that voltage difference from top to bottom is the definition of life, something your biology teacher desperately needs to know. Because then your biology teacher could design a city. It would look like a pine cone, because it would make life. It isn't complicated, right? Okay. So now we're going to apply this. So we've had this conversation. Those are the basics. The basics are that you need to create a centripetal force by getting the symmetry right. And there are atoms, and there are molecules, and there are plants, and there are people, and there are cities, and there are stars that got the geometry right. And those structures survive. Everything else does not survive. Example, Bohemia, the city of Prague. It's a rose. The layout, the magnetism, the design, the life force, the success, the alchemy, the lucid dreaming, that is a structure that's built with some approximation of the knowledge of life. And I suggest you use that as a temple for the design of your city after you eliminate some of the steel and the aluminum and the electrosmog. The principle of what is enabling a life to exist inside living material is this called charge compression, implosive centripetal compression of charge. Again, the reason a rose opens in the hand of a saint, because the field effect is centripetal. So are we clear about the electric field that causes life? We're going to move on to the technologies, but I just want to review that briefly. So now you see there is a certain symmetry that allows life to happen. And to imagine that symmetry, you know those two cones I showed you? The way you imagine that is you visualize two pine cones kissing noses. So every time I say the word phase conjugation, you say, oh, that's a complicated word. Just simply imagine two pine cones kissing noses. Then you will understand phase conjugation, whether it's optics, magnetics, dielectrics. In fact, if anybody still wants to play with these, we did this in the earlier lecture. This is called a phase conjugate dielectric. Anybody wants to play with them, feel free. You hold them here very slowly. You feel a tingle of presence. You feel metabolic acceleration. You feel sharpened perception. The physics of the royal gold crown. Feel free to try them. It's a phase conjugate dielectric. Try them here. Just very slowly up to your ears. Very slowly like this. And the field effect it's making is like two pine cones kissing roses. They're fine. We're going to sell them soon. Yeah. Just kind of relax. You feel a little very slowly right to your ears. Yeah. Kind of flat. See, you may have a little bit. It's actually true that the animal wants to kind of come. That's right. That's right. You got it here. You feel present there. Yeah. And so, and as you move away slowly, you'll actually feel the compression. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And then you can do the same thing here if you want. But so the reason you're feeling life force and metabolic acceleration is because the pine cones are kissing noses electrically, and that's causing implosive compression of chakras, and that is the definition of perception, for example. The reason why your eyesight gets so much clearer when you sit under an old-growth tree, and the reason why your eyesight gets worse when they turn on the plastic lighting and the electric smog, because focus doesn't happen. So this principle of getting to where waves meet like two pine cones kissing is actually the principle of centripetal forces. And this is how we're going to understand self-organization in life, and now we're going to go down our list of technologies. But it was important to get the principle. So for example, with that device, we have other resin crystals, which are even stronger, which we put inside of it. And we have measured a 30 to 50% increase, replicably, in metabolic rate, in metabolism. Okay? And so that increase in metabolic rate that happens inside there is the physics of life. I give you the example. We talked about last time the Seeds of Knowledge book. It's many different ways they've measured that the seed growth and life force inside Stonehenge and stone circles, the seeds germinate dramatically faster. It's a replicable, simple scientific experiment. So ask your biology teacher, why do the seeds grow faster in Stonehenge, inside the stone circle? The answer is, that is the centripetal electric field that causes life. So in the Bible, remember, we said, I will raise a shem unto the Lord, which became the word altar in church. I will build an altar in church. High word firestone. It's a fractal capacitor. The shem is a black hole-making phase-conscious dielectric capacitor. So the right kind of stones in the right kind of circle, like a rose, make a capacitive field, an electric field, a charge field, that looks like a rose. And that is centripetal, and that causes life to happen. In fact, that can actually prevent aging. So if you look carefully in the ancient literature, the Garden of Eden was an electric field to prevent aging. Hello. How do you build that electric field? We have examples. The hypogeum in Malta, the kiva in the American Southwest. These are devices that make a very particular kind of electric field called a phase conjugate dielectric. And that's one of them that we're playing with right now. And so this is a principle we need to teach to our science community, because then they'll know how to build structures that allow life to happen. Again, reviewing the physics principle, when you put the seeds in a steel or aluminum cup, you watch them die. So don't put your children in those schools. When you put seeds in a wood or stone or natural fabric cup, you watch them grow. The physics is, if you measure the capacitance, the electric field, in the steel or aluminum, you measure only one or two frequencies, which is harmonic exclusive and a charged isolator and a soul isolator. Whereas inside the cup that makes seeds grow, wood or stone or natural fabric, you measure the harmonics and you have harmonic inclusiveness and charged distribution efficiency. And that defines life, defines the sacred, defines the divine, defines perfected distribution charge. So that's the background. That's just review. We've said this 100 times. You could say, Dan, you sound like a broken record. You're right. I've said it 100 times. Hopefully you are bored, right? But this is the essential point we've made through this entire tour, and that's the review of the science. So now we'll go to the example technologies, unless anybody has any questions.
Yes.
Go ahead.
There was something, I don't know if it's right or not, what you just mentioned before. There was a show to be that in England, the women should go and sit on this low chair, and they all get pregnant after.
That's right.
Become fertile.
Yes.
And you mentioned the opera.
Yes, and maybe we should have our conversation about fractal fields and fertility first here. Right on. That's exactly where we're going with this. Yes. Good, great. Yes, any other comments or thoughts? Just about the core principle. Do you see how powerful that could be if we apply it? Yes.
The ancient buildings were always built by the golden moon ratio.
Yes. Yes. The Parthenon, the sarcophagus, the Great Pyramid, etc. They're all based on this idea that they're creating sacred space by creating charge compression. In fact, the definition of sacred is the wave that can be shared by being fractal, or as Karatkov measures it,
fractality in air. And maybe we could just review that, that measurement technique briefly, just so you kind of see the principle. Our friend Professor Karatkov, he had used the GDV system, that Curlian photography system, and he used it to measure for health, of course, and then later he was measuring the fractality in air or sacred space. Let me see if I can find the slide here.
Dan, would the...
There's the slide. Go ahead.
Would the ancient temples, which were often built on the tops of mountains, with the cities growing down below them, would they be considered that kind of kissing pine cone of the heavens, that concept of the temple peak being the peak of cone and the structure coming down the mountains being the part of the pine cone building up? Would that be a way of looking at it also in terms of analysis?
It would be fun to think about the capstone of the pyramid is a face contributor. But what's even more interesting, perhaps, is when you see the pattern of the mountaintops, if they make a pentagram, which we find at Rennes-le-Château in France, we found around Saint-Remy, the five places named Magdalene around Saint-Remy, where the Holy Grail story began and where Nostradamus' tower was. These famous pentagrams often form what was called a necropolis, a city of the dead, like Rennes-le-Château in South France. And the reason that these are cities of the dead is because this is a place where your aura, your charge, your plasma, is able to propagate, enabling lucid dreaming and death to be successful. So as an electrical engineer, I am clear that a hospital is the worst place for birth or death. Not from a medical perspective, but from the health of your aura, which is the only way you get immortal. If the correct place for birth or death is a place called sacred, where charge compression and distribution are in what's called a fractal field, a phase conjugate dielectric. An example would be the altar at Machu Picchu. This is a place where charge distribution is invited, and this is where the Anunnaki went for birth or death. And even Vincent Bridges, who's a world-class historian, who teaches the physics, or at least the science and history, behind the hypogeum cultures, the doliocephalic cultures, that built Malta, from Egypt to Malta to South France, the hermetic line, that's skilled to make that kind of structure electrically like those gold cups, was a turning point in all civilizations. We need that turning point now, the hermetic turning point. Hermes symbol, the caduceus. Definition, phase conjugation. So what Hermes, Thutmosis, the Egyptian, doliocephalic, Malta, South France, South America, they're skilled to build these underground Kiva, hypogeum, was to make the kind of capacitor that could revolutionize seed germination, initiation, and birth and death. So specifically in physics, and we've done this in the other courses, we've talked about the fact that if you measure the plasma, your aura, at death and discover where it goes, very scientifically you can describe where your ghost travels after death. And I can tell you, it doesn't travel in mental buildings very well at all. For very simple physical reasons. Okay, so just to conclude the thought that this measurement of fractality in air, which Karatkov first discovered was how you find the place the Kogi went to telephone their ancestors, is simple. The place where charge distributes efficiently, the capacitance there, this is just a titanium probe, and we're measuring the GDV fingerprint, which is just the charge distribution efficiency. Under the sacred tree, it looks like this. Inside an old metal barn, it looks like this. This is fractal. Charge distribution invited. You feel good here. Inside the old metal building, no charge distribution, and you feel like mirrored, to put it in French. And that difference is measurable. And the architect that doesn't understand that should lose his paycheck. That's my suggestion, actually. Because if you want to make a place that feels good, it also makes a place where your aura can breathe and your aura can grow. The only place where children should be. So that is the good, solid physics why Steiner was right. The children should only touch wood and stone and natural fabric. And children should never touch metal and plastic and synthetics because their aura will be trapped. And you don't want that for your children, do you?
Yeah.
Very simple. Very, very simple. Okay, so I have carried on. I've gotten too excited, as usual. And we promised technology today. Okay, so the technology. So now let us apply this. Actually, since you mentioned the issue of fertility, and we've started on that a little bit, I'd like to say that in terms of agriculture and fertility, we know, let me give you some examples of this technology applied to agriculture. Practical examples, very simple things. I don't think we brought our Agnihotra container, did we, Mallory? Here, that's so nice. has anybody seen the container typically used for Agnihotra? We should have brought it. It's basically Zoser's step pyramid made out of copper or gold. So now here you got this Agnihotra container. And I'm thinking we did this recently in Poland. And this was a farm in the middle of the wilderness. All the farms around there looked like a desert. Not so good. But this farm, it was a garden. The difference, they were doing regular Agnihotra. And they were absolutely convinced this was the solution to their fertility, agriculture. Let's discuss the physics. If we look at Agnihotra, first of all, the container, the gold or copper upside down pyramid, actually they use two pairs of cones. Does that sound like phase conjugation? Oh, yes. And they use two pair copper, this is actually the right kind of capacitor. And now you have this flame, a controlled combustion, a controlled flame inside made of biologic materials. Implosive collapsing charge. And then you time that flame with the ghee and the cow dung. You time that flame when? And why does it need to be so extremely precise with regard to sunrise and sunset? Here's the angle of the Agnihotra container. Here's the flame. Here's sunrise and sunset. The name for that principle is called phase conjugation. What does phase conjugation do? It creates a centripetal and self-organizing force that causes all the local waves of charge to be imploded into phase. In other words, everything that's destructive interference is canceled out. Electrosmog, pathology. Yes, go ahead. So that done properly, Agnihotra is a powerful environmental centripetal force. Yes, that's good. Beautiful. But thank you, sir. So let's understand that when the conjugation of phases is correct, the pine cones kiss. This is called the block wall, and this is Planck distance where there's plasma here. And here, everything behaves like a fluid. And the only thing that emerges from that golden ratio compression point is actually waves that are sorted into phase by golden ratio called self-organization by phase conjugation. Agnihotra is just one example. But notice that when you're doing this with optics, you need to line the lasers up to do this with angstrom efficiency, angstrom accuracy. So this is to say to you that when you hold these cups and when you do these rituals, accuracy does matter, actually. But if you do it right, I will tell you that you can have lasers here and speakers of sound here, and they will talk to each other there. That the sound of the light, its phase conjugation, by definition, is broad spectral. There's a question, sorry.
With respect to the sun's position, would it also be
so dramatic for us in Poland when we were at this farm, because the guy was there, he had his computer and his stopwatch and his latitude and longitude, he had plotted this thing, this was very accurate, click, millisecond, absolute, like fire now, and I swear
swear I felt like a rush just at that second. Just as that angle of the horizon was just like my hair stood up. I knew for sure he was right, you know. And you're right. What's coming from the sun is broad spectrum. You got light, you got infrared, you got ultraviolet, all kinds of spectrum. And they're conjugating precisely. Yes.
Except close encounter of their kind. When the music, you see the music at that point. Is that forever?
Well, you know, you go from the fifth to the octave. And actually, if you heterodyne those, eventually you should get a golden ratio. The meaning of perfect fifth. But that's another story.
Dad, do you think you have to do it every morning and every night? Like I have got all that here, and I've gone through that phase for years and then stopped. How often would I have to do it? Like, it is a bit limiting.
Yes. You know, I'd have to say I wouldn't be an expert on that question because I haven't done it enough myself. But I'm interested in the principle. And I believe there's lots of ways to do this, and this is only one.
Okay.
But appropriate question. In fact, Valerie might help you put you in touch with this Polish group that's very skilled on it. They speak English and they're good.
Actually, someone who would come today with her son, she lived there for a while in Holland.
Oh, I see.
I know exactly.
Wonderful.
I'll ask
her. Great. Okay, so now I wanted to mention other examples of agricultural phase conjugation. You know, of course, stirring the horn in opposite directions in biodynamics. So now you know more about how you would design the perfect horn, don't you? If the inside of that horn was a phase conjugate dielectric material, if the angle of that horn was the correct 60-degree cone, if the timing when you did it was the correct adiabatic moment, if the speed of the rotation, if the piezoelectric doping of the trace mineral manure in the water, you see? In fact, the correct thing that should be in that water is a charged rock powder. And the way you charge that rock powder, like they do at Plucker.de to create agriculture, they put it in a pyramid, the correct charge is a phase conjugate dielectric. So examples of this technology for agriculture, if we look at our purify-ecosify technologies, that the modern Ark of the Covenant, the modern pyramid, the modern, what we call the icosify, here's the icosify. These are profound charge devices, and they're designed to create that kind of charge. And when you charge rock powders in these devices, this is gold, on gold with gold. Sounds expensive, doesn't it? But, you know, this feels, when you go inside, you feel a tingle of presence. Here's 300 people in Barcelona had fun with this. And so the other example is what we call the Purify, P-Y-R-A-P-H-I, purify.com. There's the Purify. This is the container. Here's some example pictures. So this is a structure in which you can actually put these rock powders. I think we have a picture with rock powder in there here. It's a modern-day Ark of the Covenant in the sense that this technology will reduce electrosmog, will charge rock powders, which can cause water to purify and can cause accelerations in growth in agriculture when you put it in pots or the land. So this ability to charge biological structures to create life is quintessential for alternative agriculture. So one example of a group that does that with great commercial success is Plucher, P-L-O-C-H-E-R.de. There's an English section there. It's a German company. And they charge rock powders, and they're very commercially successful cleaning up dirty lakes and accelerating agriculture by simply charging a rock powder. The rock powder best is a piezoelectric material like quartz or calcite. And they keep it a secret how they charge it, but we now teach the physics and we actually provide the equipment to do it. The point is that charged rock powder inside your Steiner vortex, your preparation 501 and all that stuff, that we now know the physics of how to properly charge that rock powder. And that makes the vortex piezoelectric, and then the vortex itself becomes a source of energy. So we're going to go next to charging water in general, since that's where we're going in this. this logical progression of practical applications of this technology, which would include the imploder and other ways to implode water. But before we have that conversation, I'd like to finish the discussion about agriculture just to mention that we're working with teams of scientists who have discovered that a frequency heterodyne circuit, which happens to be key to hydrolysis, desalinization, and superconductivity and battery charging, that frequency heterodyne circuit, I have to report, we have personally seen that if you put those frequencies in a simple ground rod in the ground at a nominal distance, that there's a radical increase in soil fertility. So what we would call the principle here is called a superconductive heterodyne. And that principle is going to be behind many of the applications of this technology. In other words, if you've got two waves to recursively interfere properly around a properly tuned frequency resonant for a specific atom, that you could produce what is called an implosive or superconductive heterodyne. And I want to tell you that we have witnessed a dramatic increase in fertility and growth, and we have friends actually in Byron Bay. It will probably be Danny Schreiber's group there that will help us develop that in Byron. But we have witnessed dramatic fertility by simply ground a metal rod here, perhaps copper, here, at a nominal distance, several meters. And if you feed a phase conjugate superconductive heterodyne frequency to the soil, the bioregion for even hundreds of yards will see a dramatic increase in fertility. Another example of that is what's called the Towers of Power. Have anybody heard of those? The psychotronic groups in America? Well, our scientist friends are building them. And they put a phase conjugate dielectric, basically capacitive plates above and below, and two pine cones kissing noses in the electric field between them. And you put a frequency recipe, and you have concentric cylinders, not unlike the Joe cell, in a tower, and you've got a phase conjugate dielectric capacitor, which is simply a cone, where this is a cylinder-shaped tower. And dramatic effect on fertility of the area. Remember when Phil Callahan, who made the Tuning into Nature and all that original work on agriculture and magnetic permissivity? Well, Phil Callahan showed that in ancient Irish towers, that they would adjust the level of the dirt in the tower to tune it. For example, when the dirt was at the correct level to make the resonance frequency of the tower 1,000 hertz, then they would use it for childbirth, because that's measurably anesthesiologic, which is to say a pain reducer. And it's well known, 1,000 hertz is a frequency that you can do pain reduction. And so they would tune the Irish tower, and that was the level that the soil was put in the tower when you wanted to use that tower for childbirth. So tuned towers have an ancient tradition of being agricultural, fertility generation. The key metaphor for understanding fertility equals charge distribution efficiency is biologic. That, remember, I'm saying that charge distribution efficiency after perfect compression, called fractal, you have the possibility of perfected distribution, all radiance. And that distribution efficiency for charge is what you call the divine or sacred, what in physics would be called a fractal field, example, redox potential in a liquid, or fractality in air. This is an environment where distribution of charge is so efficient that you have life and the sacred and the divine and the voices of ancestors. A practical example from the Soupy, just one second, in the Soupy film, Meetings with Remarkable Men, why was it the saint is the person who can make Why is the holy person the one who knows how?
Testing 1, 2, 3. I think there's an echo over here. Hello, hello, hello.
In the Goethe film, the hero is the guy who knows how to make an echo. Do you know why?
Because the divine or the sacred is a perfect echo. The voice of your ancestors is a perfect echo. Where can you have a perfect echo, which is a name for a wave that lives forever? In a fractal. It's the only place. Simply, it like a rose. Yes, sir.
The towers you were talking about.
Yes.
Is the configuration important, whether it's round or square or
round? Yeah. Makes it huge. You'll probably never find a good square one. I don't think, I hope not. But round, very good. Certain cone angles, very good.
Yeah.
Basically, it's like you have a cymatic pool of waves of the dielectric field and the phonon, the sound field. And when the tuning of the geometry looks like a rose, which is often pentagonal and usually golden ratio related, you get conjugation of phases and light force. Simple. And that same geometry lesson applies at the atomic level. The gold, for example, the electron shells, dodecaposta complete. That metaphor applies at the molecular level, the water molecules that make a dodecahedron, DNA. That metaphor applies at architectural levels, cyma erecta, cyma reversa, our waveguides for whether the plasma, the charge, goes up or down. And insects navigate by proper agriculture, by proper architecture, because the plasma projection from the architecture is the waveguide for insects and lucid dreaming and life force injection. And that metaphor geometrically also then applies at interstellar levels. You know, the Earth grid is dodeca. The universe is dodeca. Buckminster Fullerene is dodeca. The foundation stone of Steiner is dodeca. Ezekiel's wheel, city of Revelation, is dodeca. Merkaba is dodeca. It's a mark of pressure.
Dan, would you say that the fractal field itself is holographic? In its wave strength repetition and the ability that you go to where you point in the holograph and see the whole field?
I would say specifically the only mechanism which allows a hologram to contain information about every point at one point is specifically fractal, which is to say perfected compression. In other words, the hologram that can maintain itself without added energy can only be fractal. So another way of saying that is fractality is always the only perfected form of coherence. There is no other form of perfected coherence which is not fractal, in my humble opinion, actually. All right, so we're transitioning from a conversation about fractal applications to agriculture over to water. So now we're going to talk about practical applications to water. Remember, our theme is implosive collapse. And we're showing this example. This is the old example, but it's kind of fun. We have Victor Schauberger. Victor Schauberger is stepping into... slide number 412. Here we are. Victor Schauberger steps into Hitler's treasury office. And they decide to give Victor Schauberger a check. And the reason they gave Victor Schauberger a check is because Schauberger delivered an electricity generator. And this is it. The electricity generator was a vortex. This is similar to what is now being built, actually what they're using at Implosion Research Lab, Jonathan Dolly, in Plymouth, in UK. This is an example of implosive collapse. Gaining energy during collapse. So ideally, this egg would be calculated correctly based on real Osterjig and correct equations you could find in Vortex of Life, Fields of Form, Lawrence Gardner's work. And correctly, the inside of the container would ideally be a phase conjugate material, a gold, palladium, or platinum. It's very good. In Implosion Research Lab in UK, they're using silver. The scale here would have to do with hydrogen and black, ideally, and I don't think they knew that in UK. The speed of the flat impeller there in Implosion Lab was 50,000 RPM, as I recall. And like the vortex in Steiner's work, the water in here needs to be highly charged, highly organized water, and then we'll have a piezoelectric dopant, which is to say, a little bit of the charged rock powder, to make it piezoelectric. What does piezoelectric mean? It means that a compression wave of sound creates a voltage. How does piezoelectricity work? The two ideal examples are DNA and quartz. And in both cases, they're piezoelectric because they're a slinky. A slinky has a geometry like DNA and quartz. DNA is a ratcheted dodeca of a slinky. Quartz is actually a cube, SiO2 bond, which is stepped up a hexagonal helix, and that is quartz, SiO2. And the reason that both DNA and quartz are piezoelectric is that they are a slinky. And the reason slinky is the only way to make something piezoelectric is because in every case, the change in length this way on the long axis, this is the sound wave, produces a slight change in this thickness here. So when I pull on the ends, you notice that the sides come in just a little bit. This is a long wave here, which is mechanically connected to this short wave here, because it's getting thinner as I lengthen it. So this is a long wave, and this is a short wave, and they are coupled. They are connected. You know how you talk to God if you're a human? You connect a long wave to a short wave. Well, how do you connect long waves to short waves? It's called piezoelectric, which means the sound wave, the long wave, is mechanically connected to the voltage wave. In both cases, that wave is pressure. This is a pressure of sound, and this is a pressure of voltage. The name for voltage is tension. It means pressure. So voltage and amperage are just names for pressure and flow, literally. So all electric fields behave like a fluid, and voltage and amperage, voltage is a name for pressure in that fluid, and amperage is a name for rate of flow. And pressure times flow, volts times amps, equals work done, called watts. I point out this because it's so helpful to realize that all of physics behaves like a fluid. Okay. So now, this fluid is piezoelectric, and that means that as the, remember now you're visualizing two pine cones kissing noses. So what's happening here? The reason Hitler wrote the check was because there was a voltage difference from here to here. And that voltage came from gravity, and this was called a nonlinear generator, what you would call a zero-point machine. The physics is that that energy should definitely not be called free energy because it's not free. It came from gravity. And sometimes mother's milk comes with a price. That's mother's milk. But this was a nonlinear energy device. This is a generator. And where you put it has a lot to do with how much power comes out. So ideally, this will be related to golden ratio as a wave function. And you have golden ratio heterodyning among the waves, and that will be measurable. Now, if you're good, if you really understood the things that we've been saying before, you can tell me the polarity of this voltage from here to here. I will tell you it's a DC voltage, but do you know the polarity? I think, good. Serge, go to heaven class. This would probably be electronegative because it's a centripetal point, yeah? And we're saying that all electronegativity is precisely fractal. You know, our friend Jerry Tennant wrote a whole book saying the part of your body that's electronegative is health, healing is voltage. The part of your body that's electropositive is unhealthy. Electronegativity defines fractality. In other words, the part of you that's attracting charge is always electronegative. In the same way, alkalinity in blood is fractal. At any rate, so you see this idea that now there is the some of the capacitive wave, the voltage wave, is adding and multiplying its phase velocity, and charge is going through the speed of light here, making a little bit of gravity and extracting voltage from gravity. So this device gets voltage from gravity the same way a pine cone does. Too bad your local physicist doesn't know that, because then we'd have a planet that could get voltage from gravity the way pine cones do. This is an example of pine cone physics.
We should look at the science of what the pyramid is doing. That's very appropriate. And the pyramid science, like the icosify-pyrify, this is a form of a pyramid, except this pyramid actually is, this pyramid I have scaled to hydrogen and Planck. And I have made the angles accurate, and I have made this a phase-conjugate dielectric capacitor, and we get accelerated metabolism in sacred space. Now, what do we know about pyramids? We know that you can sharpen a razor blade or preserve meat. But do you know why? That
You know, the atom at the edge of the razor blade is basically a wave made of charge. A pyramid is sometimes called a gravity diode in the sense that it's a one-way gate for charge, making centripetal force. So the reason the atom at the edge of the razor blade doesn't bleed charge is because the charge in the center of the pyramid is centripetal, which is to say, prevents the charge from bleeding. Remember, bleeding charge defines pain. So if a fractal gets a corner broken off the fractal, it starts to bleed charge, and that creates a voltage, which is what happens when you cut your finger. And the amount of voltage there determines how fast it heals. It's called the current of injury, actually. So the actual pain you feel is actually the voltage bleeding where the fractal has lost compression. Now, the psychological side of that would be the Andromedan saying, the only pain you feel is the love you withhold, which is to say the compression you withhold. So if you actually restore that compression magnetically and dielectrically, restore the fractal, the pain goes away. And that's true physically and psychologically. At any rate, the point we want to make here, if you take that same razor blade, which got sharp in a pyramid, if you put it out on the windowsill in a full moon, it gets dull faster. You know why? Because the moon is opposite to a phase conjugate dielectric. It's a hollow metal titanium sphere. And it prevents charge compression, which is why you avoid the moon if you'd like a seed to grow. So you understand the principle that centripetal forces are the solution to what was supposedly a mystery. Yeah? Okay. So we're moving on in magnetic and implosive water treatment. We're trying to give examples of implosive collapse applied to water. And that, of course, brings us to our invention, the imploder. The imploder is a device which I took this equation. Here. This is the shape we've been discussing all day. And I spent several years converting that to a CAD-CAM, to a computer-aided design vortex nozzle construction called the imploder. And what's happening to the water when it comes down this cone is implosive collapse. It gains inertia. And we have a little animation here. Let's see, is it this one? I can find that fun little movie here. You see a little bit of the cone, no? The water that comes out the nozzle looks like a ponytail, and it's sensitive. You can actually pet the ponytail. And the reason, here it is, we have a better animation, but I kind of lost it. But when the water comes out here, it makes it cone-like ponytail, and when you touch it, the ponytail jumps out to meet you. It seems like it's self-aware. It's also silkier water, and we have a solubility effect that I'd like to tell you about. We've actually measured the effect on eliminating chlorine, but for most of the effects that we measured, we use this in conjunction with a magnetic array, which I'll show you a picture of. So the water comes down that cone, and it's gaining inertia during implosive collapse. We call this Schauberger's dream. It's the imploder. And the point is that we've had dramatic success in agriculture, actually. Right, click over here, try that again. Anywhere from 30 to 200% growth effects. Although now we know that there's a difference between the growth in the germination phase and the growth in the fruiting phase. One is more centripetal and one's more centrifugal, and I will explain. So we attach here an array of magnets. And these magnets are cylindrical, and they're very powerful. And we use them in the phase conjugate position, which is two magnets where the like poles, which would normally repel, can actually attract. And the word we use for that is called phase conjugate magnetics. And I can show you one example. I think I have an animation here. Mm-mm. Where we like to show this to scientists because it helps them to fall off their chair. It's called
phase conjugate magnetics where the like poles attract. And actually, it's not that mysterious why it works. But if you take two magnets and you line them up precisely, here's an animation.
This is the like pole of the magnet. This is south, and that's south. So those are two magnetic south poles. And this is a material which is high magnetic flux permissivity. So right there, the two south poles are now stuck together. And this is a magnet so strong that it can hurt you. And the two south poles are firmly attached, firmly. And if you made a map of the angle of the magnetic lines that allow the two like poles to attract, it's called phase conjugation. It would be like two pine cones kissing noses. And so what you get there is extreme flux density at the center point, and that's what we use, although in a new version of the imploder, we're actually improving upon this. But I'm just using this to illustrate the principle. So we got water that comes down that tube, and then it enters a compression point called a Z-pinch for magnetic lines. So the water molecule is now spinning. When a spinning molecule enters a strong magnetic field, that's called a motor. And the spinning molecule converts the mechanical spin of the molecule into voltage, which is what an electric motor is. And that has a result on the molecule of the water like the molecule of gold in the Ark of the Covenant, which is to say it becomes stable as a monoatom. So let's just play with that just briefly. Here, if you take a gold atom, which is yellow, and you put it in a phase conjugate dielectric spark gap, like the Ark of the Covenant, that gold atom will turn inside out like popcorn, change mass measurably, and start to float. It's called Ormes, or the spice, or mana? Mana? Monoatomic gold. It was then became called Holy Communion. And so that process of creating that gold atom, which was now newly stable as a monoatom, and therefore very shareable, maximized surface area, increased solubility. So now that gold atom is soluble in water and blood, so take a little of this and live forever. That's what Lawrence Gardner says. He forgot the fine print. It may cost you your soul, but we'll go there later. But the point is, the physics of what's happening to our water molecule in the imploder is the same. Centripetal force, added spin, fractal field, implosion, turn inside out. We now have a water molecule that is stable as a monomolecule, which is to say it's stable as a smaller molecular cluster size with the result of dramatically increased charge density, decreased entropy, which is, say, increased order, all of which is measured, and the silky effect, which is solubility. So it tastes silky, it feels silky, and truly, we have all these wonderful agricultural effects. And I'll just show you some more of the pictures here. On the website, theimploder.com, you will see the measurements of entropy, the measurements of radiance, the measurements of order, and yes, here's can't see very well those. That's the entropy measure. That used the GDV system actually. Dramatically increased entropy order at the molecular level. This is the and this we've actually replicated. This is an almost 200% difference in beans, in bean growth. And this they did this, we did this south France, and got very similar results in Western Canada as well. We now know that in the current imploder, we emphasize the south pole centripetal forces, which is better for germination, but not ideal for fruiting. And we're dealing with those issues in a new version of the imploder, which is due out within a month. But that's a very good metaphor, because if you think about it, what most people don't know is the south pole is more centripetal, and the north pole is more centrifugal in magnetism and in charge in general. In fact, I urge you to try the experiment. A very strong south pole of a magnet on your toothache increases the pain and the healing rate. the North Pole, the same magnet on the same toothache, decreases the pain and the healing rate. Your homework is to know why. You see that pain is a name for your body is trying to restore implosive compression. That's what pain is. So if you restore the compression, the waves get sorted. That's called a fight in an Irish pub. That's called healing, right? So this ability to do compression and emerge, fighting in Irish bars, which is to say, to discover the new symmetry. So once you get the compression right, the sorting is restored. So the South Pole, by increasing compression, actually increases the healing rate, which is sort of allopathy. Let's focus the damn pain. You know, we Scorpios love that. It's called stick. As opposed to allopathy versus homeopathy. I'm sorry. Homeopathy is to focus the pain. Allopathy is to diffuse the pain. So the homeopath uses the South Pole. The allopath uses the North Pole. Do you see the difference? It's called getting focused. Because that's what this is about. It's focus. That's what the pine cones kissing are about. So you see the medical applications. And actually, we don't even have that on our list today, but in the icosify construction in South France, we are building phase conjugate magnetics specifically to do pain reduction studies. And there is a precedent for that, Elizabeth Rauscher's work, which is another long story. But she actually measured the harmonics of magnetism, which significantly, dramatically eliminated pain in a very expensive FBA study. And later, we actually calculated the frequencies she used, and it fit the equation for phase conjugation. So we actually know the frequency of magnetic harmonics to restore compression and eliminate pain. It's about restored fractality. Anyway, to sort of finish the story about the imploder, so I'll just show you some more of the pictures. This is the bean growth difference. This is the Western Canada study after June. This is 1 month, a little less than a month, the difference in bean growth. And we have the radish growth here. There's a radish. That's early picture of the beans. This is early germination, particularly for the germination, the South Pole. It's very excellent for the germination phase. So there's lots of studies, and we have results from around the world. And now we're going from this 3/4 inch, which is basically a home size unit. In 1 month, we will now have a unit which is a 1.5 and 2 inch diameter for commercial agriculture. So, implosion in water. You see what we're doing? We're adding centripetal force. The molecule becomes more organized, imploded water, increased solubility. It tastes very silky. It's fabulous for the swimming pool. And the irrigation people are excited because they believe that this wetter water will reduce the amount of pesticide and sprays required because they better distribute in the country.
More likely to be more readily taken up by the plants themselves.
Yes. Sure. That's a great idea. And we're going to set up the biofeedback gizmo, which takes a minute. Yes. So we're about to demonstrate some biologic applications. And this is, first, I wanted to finish the discussion about water. If you look at, can we turn this light off here? The fluorescent ones. That's great. Thank you. So this is called the sevenfold flow form. And if you look at the way that dish is beating, I'd like you to observe the beat pattern. That beat pattern, here's one dish beating down here. I'll turn that sound back up. So this is called a sevenfold flow form. But the dishes themselves are golden ratio, and the rate at which the dishes beat is golden ratio. And that produces the surface tension and the implosive effect. So if you do that at higher pressure, you have our imploder. But this is John Wilkes' intuition when he built the flow forms,
And his intuition did end up at golden mean ratio, both in the scale of the dishes and the relative beat rate. So the reason that that dish is beating, you see how the top one is beating at 1.618 times the frequency of the one below it. And they all beat like this. You see that little heartbeat kind of thing here? So where we're going next with this is the heartbeat, actually. What I wanted to show you was that the concept of the flow form idealized is actually golden ratio. That's the point. So the next application that we're going to discuss, remember we're discussing practical applications of implosive collapse. And if you were thinking about the question, yes. Yes, although the imploder is perhaps a little better on the discharge end rather than the input end, so that the effect at the molecular level is more sustainable. But if you look at your heartbeat and the electrical origins of your heartbeat, you find that your heartbeat also is an example of implosive collapse. That the place where your heart gets voltage from gravity is fractal. And the picture I want to show you is called the fibers of Purkinje, which is a fractal branching structure. This, if your little child ever asks you, where does my heartbeat come from? It's actually proven electrically that the structure that allows your heart to get voltage from gravity, the fibers of Purkinje, are based on fractality, which is to say it's a tree structure that's so fractal that it can implode charge. So now you can understand better why your heart has more voltage available to beat when you're in nature. Whereas if you're in the city with metal buildings, your heart does not have the voltage available so easily to beat because the environment is not fractal. And so you can't implode charge there. For the same reason, later when we measure the human bliss process, that trying to sustain bliss in a metal building in a polluted city is unwise. Because when you implode, and that's called human bliss, you actually suck in your environment. And you do not want to suck in a poisonous environment. So I actually do not recommend bliss process in metal buildings or electrosmog or air-conditioned air or polluted cities. It's why you need nature. You need places that are fractal. So what we're looking at here, Valerie was kind enough to help us set up the heart tuner. So now we're measuring that fractal voltage from the heart. And what I'd like to show you, we have two gentlemen connected. On channel A, we have strong heart here. Yes, it's good. Also, there's a little difference in conductivity on the wrist. But what we're getting a very strong heartbeat on channel B. And if you analyze the difference, actually, these are the harmonics present. So the idea is that you recognize when I take a frequency signature, this is my heart tuner invention, and I'm measuring the harmonics present in their heart. And this should look familiar to you. What do you call that? A caduceus. It's a harmonic series. These are the frequencies from 0 to about 25 hertz present in the EKG. The newest is on the bottom. And so you analyze for missing harmonics, because if there's a harmonic missing, it means the fractal is bleeding. Like in the case of Fred there, your missing harmonic is around 6 hertz. Now if we check that carefully, that may be a perfect octave of 50 cycle, suggesting 50-cycle electrosmog issues. A lot of people have that peak missing, although it's minor there. But when you have too much 50-cycle, your body becomes armored to that frequency, harmonics of 50-cycle, which would include the 6.25 hertz. And so what we measure here is this coherence. When this peak goes up, that's a measure of coherence. And the point is that that's a kind of a lie detector because, or it measures kinesiology, because when your heart says yes to something, it becomes coherent. So actually, Wojtek, if you would do something with me, don't move, but just take a really deep breath. Breathe in, and then out. That's good. And now take a smaller breath. Breathe in.
now, Wojtek, just relax and be still for a minute. Just relax. So what I'd like you to observe, folks, is that, and you could look here too, Wojtek, if you'd like. Here, this is Wojtek's breathing as measured by the accelerometer, I'm sorry, by the tachometer, which is measuring the milliseconds between the heartbeat peaks. And when Wojtek creates a caduceus with his breathing, and then a still point, at the end of the caduceus breathing, you have coherence increase. So this was the height of this peak here. So his heart said yes after he did that. You know why his heart said yes? His heart said yes because he did harmonic inclusive breathing, which produces what's called heart rate variability. Heart rate variability is something that's, this, unfortunately, we have some noise here because we're getting a weak signal in channel 8, but this is real data here for heart rate variability, and it is showing, Wojtek, generally low heart rate variability, which means, it's simple, it means you need more exercise. It's very common, but it's true. You see, young people have lots of variability, but no coherence. You have lots of coherence, but low variability. You know, this means that you can hold a thought, very coherent. But low variability means that you don't change heart rate very much, and therefore don't change emotion enough, because that's the range of motion. And actually, to finish, because we're only going to do a very short session on the heart tuner today, but I want to say that the major lesson here is fractality, which is to say, any doctor knows that a fractal heart is a healthy heart. The way that's measured is called variability. If this is harmonic inclusive, which here it is not, unfortunately, but if this is a caduceus of harmonics, it means strong immune system. But when that's not a caduceus of harmonics, actually what it's saying to us, Wojtek, is that it would be good to think about doing something to get your heart rate really high once every day or two. And if you did that, variability comes back, and that indicates a much stronger immune system. So when a doctor wants to measure your immune system for health, he measures this, heart rate variability, and checks for harmonic inclusiveness, which is a caduceus cascade, and the word for that is fractal. That's why doctors say a healthy heart is a fractal heart. That's what they mean. In other words, the heart needs implosive collapse. Another way to put that, the way this Irving Dardik discovered this was, he discovered that if you teach an Olympic athlete to do his exercise where your heart rate does this, high and then low and then stop, that's a recipe for heart attacks all over the place. It's a perfect way to get a heart attack is to do extreme heart rate up and then stop. That's a square wave for your heart, and that is murderous. He had Olympic athletes dying right and left. Then he did the opposite. He taught the Olympic athletes to have the heart rate do this, called a caduceus.
How do you do that?
You do that so that your first run gets your heart rate as high as you can, and then you relax a bit, and your heart rate comes down. And then, now your second run, your heart rate wants to go 0.618 as high. And then you relax. And then you do a third run, which is just a slight exercise. And then after you do that, it's called Cyntic Cycle, or it was called Cycles. Irving Dardik's book is called Making Waves. He's famous. He was the director of the Olympic Medical Committee, and he produced a recipe for Olympic athletes based on heart rates called Making Waves. And he was so successful that it became illegal. but it's actually true. That because he was doing energy medicine, what would happen is you download from your wristwatch the map of your heart rate of the last several days. And the doctor looks and says, oh, you're at the office and you got flat heart rate for 8 hours and then you went and ran around like a chicken and no wonder you're dying. So he says, well, at about 11:30 in the morning, your heart rate's gonna need to do such and such. And then in the afternoon, your heart rate such and such. And he made a prognosis telling you what part of your day needs a different heart rate. And he healed so many diseases that was shocking to the American medical system. He was healing diseases all over the map. Simply
so
by tuning
in the morning, you exercise stronger, then you do a little bit more relaxed exercise.
Caduceus. The thing that's really fatal is a flat heart rate unchanged for hours at a time. Your body is not designed for that.
What about the effect of, pranayama breathing? Because we breathe at certain rates, like 4-6, 4-6, or whatever.
Yes.
Do you measure those things?
Yes, well, heart rate variability is the way doctors measure breathing. And heart rate variability is the way yogis control their spinal fluid with the low frequencies of the heart, which is the low frequencies of your breathing. So effectively, you see this frequency here at 0.02 hertz means that he's breathing at only about once every 20 seconds. It's suggesting, sir, that you are a bit of a shallow breather, I'm sorry to say, and which is not so good. But it's very common. We didn't mean to pick on you today, sorry.
there's a mathematical relationship between the breath rate, the heart rate, and the heart rate variability.
Yes, heart rate variability is this. We take a tachometer here. You can take that off now. We're not going to pick on you anymore, we promise. You have been so good to share your heart. Thank you, sir. No, and very good to hear, sir. But what we did is if we take this graph here, which is the graph of his change in heart rate, it's a tachometer, and you spectrum analyze that, and that's called heart rate variability. And the reason is, remember when he breathed in, and we saw the caduceus here? The reason is when you breathe in, your heart rate goes up, and you breathe out, your heart rate goes down.
Yeah.
That's why the graph of the tachometer is your breath.
So breathing in and holding the breath and then breathing out, and that's a good way to create variability.
You could do that, and actually you could tune that to look more like a caduceus and do it better, according to this idea. Yes? Yes.
May I ask you, so would be a good idea if you want to go say around in the football game, in the 4 to 5 reps. The first rep you run, you walk, then you start running, then you slow down, you jog, then you increase the heart rate again, and then you jog, and so on.
What?
Say, after that, you walk, or the first step you walk, the second one, you start doing jogging, then again, after that, you running, then you jog, then you run. Is that the right way of doing?
Well, what I can tell you is what the graph of your heart rate should look like. So let me be very specific here. You know, I say the word caduceus, and many people, don't really visualize what that means. So here, let's review what that is. This
is a caduceus. So what I'm saying to you is that from a medical perspective, if this were the graph of your heart rate, that would be the perfect exercise. I can tell you for sure.
So the high one shows when you are very fast, right?
This is high heart rate.
Yes.
This is low heart rate.
Oh, yes.
High heart rate, low heart. This is the graph of the perfect heart rate.
Okay, yeah.
And I'm absolutely certain.
Okay. So you'll stop all of a sudden, yeah?
No, that's right. This is the perfect heart rate change. If you do this, and that's where we're going next. We're going to apply this to brain waves, a technology. This is called implosive collapse, the subject of our day. This is called the caduceus. In physics, this is called phase conjugation. And in hydrodynamics, this is called perfect damping. And in hydrodynamics, it's well known that perfect damping is defined by golden ratio, the golden ratio, the golden ratio, golden ratio, golden ratio, golden ratio. That is a caduceus. That is implosion. That is perfect damping. And that is implosive collapse. And that's the subject of everything we're discussing today. And we just applied it to the heart.
The reason I ask you is because I do go to the football ground.
Okay.
The first leg, I walk.
I see.
Then I start after jogging. Then I go fast, then jog, and so on. At the end, I walk the last leg.
So I think that's a beautiful way because you're doing it gradually, but this is suggesting that you do that process a second time at 0.618 as fast a heartbeat. That's what this is. Yes, sir.
So, Dan, I just wanted to check what's the recommended time to do the initial exercise.
You know, if you're a microorganism, it might be a millisecond. If you're a dinosaur, it's probably weeks, you know. This is global scaling. It depends on your size. But if you think to yourself, what is a comfortable period that it takes you to get to your
0.618 for the next 0.618 as high, a heart rate. That would give you an idea, the global scale. If this theoretically is the perfect exercise, I repeat, the physics of the perfect exercise. And at the climax here, this is when you do Kundalini yoga, and then you produce this in your brain waves, which is what we're going to show you right now. But question first.
Yeah, that breathing technique, do you have a measurable effect on the vortex breathing rate? So that was almost like 4, 3, 2, 1.
Is the caduceus, ideally, I mean, actually, I used to start all my conferences with a caduceus breathing exercise with the groups, actually, all of them. And
it's magical. Here, let's try it. Okay, we're doing this. All right. So you're relaxed, right? Okay, so you're relaxed. Okay, so now, when I tell you, you're going to take the largest possible breath in through your nose and out through your mouth. Okay? Ready? Breathe in. Now, a smaller breath, 0.618. Breathe in. Smaller breath, 0.618. Breathe in. Now, a tiny breath. Breathe in. And now, just a little one. Breathe in. And now, enter the stillness together.
Indicate different health conditions. And that's a whole other course that we don't have time for today. But I can tell you there's 10,000 papers in the American medical literature on heart rate variability. It's the hottest subject in medicine today. Guess why? Because they know you either get fractal or you get dead.
It's simple. But since we have limited time today, unless there's anything else you want to talk about, and remember, we've been teaching my heart to intervention for 15 years.
So I was going to move on and just briefly apply implosive collapse to brain waves.
So remember, there's this whole series of experiences in the brainwave literature showing that indeed, for example, when you teach children to see without their eyes, the way that peak perception and world without blindness happens, children see without their eyes, they visualize that they're in beautiful nature. And then, if you measure the children who in fact can see without their eyes, a very well-known phenomena, the measurement you make is golden mean ratio in the brain waves. So brain waves that make the frequency of golden mean ratio, very measurable, very common, is the way you measure for peak perception. Also, you measure cross-hemispheric coherence and, of course, aura fractality. So your aura gets larger and more fractal when you make golden ratio in your brain waves. And in fact, in history,
in the previous study with a group called the Mind Mirror, the map of alpha, beta, delta, theta brainwave frequencies showed that golden mean ratio between alpha and beta and delta indicated what they called spiritual state, creative inspiration. This is a medical study that involved tens of thousands of people. The frequency between the alpha and the beta goes to golden mean ratio. And that's the way you measure spirituality, creativity. And the reason is because the frequency of the alpha and the frequency of the beta.
The frequency. So the average frequency of the alpha band or whatever.
Not the average, the peak amplitude frequency.
Because alpha is a range.
Yes, but the peak frequency in the power spectra in the alpha bandwidth is so it's actually the alpha frequency as ratio to the beta frequency is where you start this. So here's the alpha frequency, in this case 9.5 hertz is the 9.75, and here's the beta. And the frequency ratio, when it's golden mean, indicates enlightenment, which is to say implosive collapse, which is to say peak perception.
So it's between alpha and beta, or what?
No, it's actually alpha to beta to delta to theta. It's the whole thing. In fact, in the good ones, we have 5 harmonics in golden ratio. We'll show you a few of them.
So this is alpha to beta. We're having a little computer glitch on the one where I have 5 harmonics in golden ratio. One moment. But it's actually alpha, beta, and here's the delta. You'll see that more in some of these other animations. If I think I lost one of my little movies here somehow. Yeah, I don't know what happened there. It's too bad. I have it over here. I'll use another one. One moment. Because this is a lady. Her name is Brenda from Byron Bay, and she says, quote, she lives in a bliss state. Actually, and here is Brenda. And Brenda's like this. She's having this. She's in bliss. And if you look at her brain waves at that moment, here's the alpha 9 hertz. Here's the beta. I'm sorry, here's the beta. There's the delta. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 5 harmonics in the golden mean ratio, which is the way you measure peak perception, because that is the frequency ratio your brain does to do this electrically around your body. And that's called enlightenment. It means compression precedes radiance. You can become a fractal attractor, and that's very attractive. So we're not going to connect brain waves today because it's hard work, and it's tricky, and it's difficult. And most people can't do it, I'm sorry. But very few people can do it. But I suggest it's worth learning. But, you know, a lot of people just barely can make a little bit of alpha. But people who don't make alpha are often alcoholic. Do you know why? Because if you don't make alpha, when you close your eyes, it's dark inside your head. And so you drink beer, and alcohol makes the oxygen down, conductivity up, and alpha is easier to make, so the lights go on. Now, the physics of neurofeedback to end addiction, end attention deficit is really quite simple. So after 2 weeks of, you know, a half-hour session, whatever it takes, a little Pac-Man game, you learn to make alpha frequency. And it's invariable. On the day the alcoholic learns to make the alpha, the next drink of beer on that day will make him feel sick. He won't whine anymore. It's simple physics. The only reason you wanted the alcohol was to complete the charge compression that allows your aura to sort itself out, called peak perception. So the physics is that the addiction is a wrong turn on the right road. why we wrote the book, which are gone here. But we wrote the book and say, you should admire your children for risking their lives, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, in order to get bliss. Because your children are correct to know that they must have a bliss experience or they don't lucid dream, get immortal, survive death, and see a tornado. If you don't get a big aura, you're toast. So your children are correct to risk their lives to get a big aura. And so the definition of culture is whether or not you know how to teach your children how to have bliss. If you do, that's called culture. If you don't, sorry. You know, your brand of beer and wine and petunias do not define culture. No. What defines immortality is quite clear. It's whether your children get a large aura. Therefore, to know whether you have culture, check to see if you know how to teach your children how to have bliss. Very simple.
What hemisphere of the brain is affected by alpha and by beta?
The measurements are clear that the onset of peak perception and bliss specifically requires the disappearance of bilateral asymmetry. That means both hemispheres are absolutely required. Because otherwise the two pine cones do not kiss noses. So you measure
you need both the frequency to line up between the right and left hemisphere, and additionally, it's important, and you can see whether you have right-left hemisphere dominance by the amplitude. So both frequency and amplitude need symmetry in the same way that the lasers must meet precisely oppositely to phase conjugate. Any other questions?
So, we have now applied implosive collapse to
agriculture, to water, to the heart, to the brain waves. We have not yet discussed hydrogen, and we have not yet discussed the stock market. So now we will discuss hydrogen. So again, we're reviewing practical applications for technology. So that technology we've described in bliss movement is basically how to invent biofeedback to teach bliss, peak perception, and end addiction, attention deficit. Essentially, when you have bliss, you're biologically attractor for all living charge, which is the final form of all biologic information, which is then thus defines the final form of education. So you have books, and then you have universities, and you have the internet, and then you have bliss. Bliss makes all of the preceding obsolete, absolutely. And that is why I am able to talk fast, for example. Okay? It literally means you have access to all biological information. There are many stresses that are associated with intense bliss. It has nutritional requirements. It has environmental requirements. It produces a sensitivity that's life-threatening. There are many issues. But intense bliss process is clearly the final form of biological information. It's true. And it's then how you get the kind of aura that you take with you when you die. A good indication is whether you can lucid dream. And the coherence you take with you into your dreaming is very much dependent upon access to bliss. For example, African or Aboriginal tribes, when they had a bliss process, did not get disease or addiction. They only got addiction and disease when they lost their bliss process. So when the physics of bliss is well taught, indigenous peoples can be understood and empowered. Yes?
Can you give us an idea?
A Sufi dance can be an example. Sacred circle dance, arrhythmia, there are many forms. But in each case, the physics is like the proteins in cell metabolism doing meiosis. That's called a ritual. The physics of ritual is the short wave embeds in the long wave.
So that embedding process, here's a short wave that embeds in a long wave.
So the ability of the short wave to nest non-destructively in a long wave becomes recursive and centripetal, called implosive collapse. Have you heard of the word before? and so that process of recursive embedding is the physics of what electric field is generated during ritual. It's why your hair stands up when you watch the sacred dance and you
because the sacred gymnastic was a way of creating capacitance.
In that critical scene, this is an example of a so you have two opposing cones, precisely phase locked, frequency one half the other. Actually, golden ratio would be better. So that's called phase conjugation into the heart. So we're building extreme capacitance,
yeah?
Charge density. So this ability to hold that charge requires discipline. You have frequency X, X over 2, X over 4. Perfect phase lock, perfect phase discipline. It should be in a room that contains living material, and it should be done in nature. And that kind of activity builds a collective plasma field, which then produces lucid dreaming and a large aura. This is from the film Meetings with Remarkable Men about George Gurdjieff, the climax scene of the sacred gymnastic. So when you teach your children how to have bliss, it's a science of hygiene, which replaces religion, actually. And that science involves eating live food, avoiding angry DNA in your diet, and doing kinesthetic, some form of movement, yoga, sacred gymnastic, etc. And then it involves living in a place of charge, which means avoiding dead air and dead buildings because your aura dies. Very simple. So then your aura can grow, and that is the purpose of life. It doesn't require a thick book to learn the purpose of life. It's a very thin book. Because if you get a big aura, you steer tornadoes and you live forever. Otherwise, you're toast. Doesn't sound complicated to me. So, we were moving on in the technology field here. We're going to talk about hydrogen. So the point is that once I showed that the frequency signature of hydrogen was identified by golden ratio, both as to radius and frequency, we identified a series of frequency signatures, which we started a research project here with in Melbourne with the help of Ian and Serge. And also then we had the benefit of being joined by other scientists. Ian has an amazing network here, which is fabulous, but also there's another scientist who we need to keep confidential from now. We call him the professor. But he had developed a phase conjugate heterodyne where you use an adjacent frequency precisely to the key frequency of hydrogen and oxygen. And then you heterodyne those two adjacent frequencies precisely around the key resonant frequency of hydrogen. And the curvature, the harmonics of those heterodynes, he calls it the slew rate, is precise so that you actually phase conjugate, implode, and break the hydrogen bond. The way to visualize that is simple. If you're stirring a vortex in water, like Schauberger or Callan Coates' work, if the vortex comes to a needle point, you know that the water is actually getting sorted. It's implosion. The needle point of that vortex is just like the heterodyne of frequencies, the frequency interference, that becomes so phase accurate that it goes to like gigahertz, even though you started in the audio. And that business of getting an infinite recursive wave interference, let's call it the perfect echo, that process is actually how you break the hydrogen bond. And so this circuit is, we're deep in the middle of this research and it's going well. To understand that a little bit, for really, we could almost call it explosive or radical hydrolysis to burn water, the film we're making is called The Cool Fuel. Martin Selecki, who made all the films with Callum Coates and on the Schauberger work, has joined our team, which is wonderful, from Byron. And he's a filmmaker and does this sort of work. But to understand it, I give you the metaphor. There is a group called the Bedini Group in the States. They just had a big conference in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. And we're focusing on the technology aspect here today. But In that group, they have, here's the picture I want.
Imagine that you had the output voltage of a signal generator that made a voltage picture like this. Imagine what that would do to healing. Imagine that would do to fertility. Imagine what that would do to agriculture. I'm going to give you some examples because that curve is actually, quote unquote, an infinite battery charger. Now, if you want to see infinite battery charging, check out the Bedini circuit. The Bedini circuit produces a voltage wave, which does that kind of thing. I wanted to show you examples applied to health and then battery charging, because actually the circuit we're using does both. And here's an example. I just want to show you one thing. I just had it up here a little while ago, one moment. We were investigating a center in Switzerland that does electronic healing technologies. And we were looking at the VOLE system. Where did I put that picture? I just had it on here. And the, oh, here it is. There it is. Thank you for your patience. So this is the Scanner. This is just one example. There are many such systems. This is a device where you connect a voltage wave, and here is the voltage wave. We measured it on the oscilloscope of the Scanner system, approximating a golden ratio caduceus, and you apply that voltage from the probe here in a pentagram called golden ratio on the body, and you achieve dramatic pain reduction. Restored compression. Now imagine you had the output of that voltage wave and instead used it for battery charging. Well, the Bedini people produced a pulse series, pulse generation, that creates implosive collapse, and they have what could be called superconductive battery charging. Now this circuit that we're developing is achieving right now superconductive battery charging. Batteries that take normally 4 to 8 hours to charge, charged in 4 to 10 minutes, for example. And this technology is in its infancy, but it works. It's real. And I'm just teaching you the concept in principle, because part of our mission in technology is educational. And I want people to understand the concept. And so in that regard, I'm going to show you one more little example. Technology that applies this. And here it is, hydrogen. This is a device called the Steorn device in Ireland. It's very famous. And this is the output voltage wave of that device. That should look a little familiar to you, doesn't it? That's called implosive collapse, perfect damping. It's the voltage wave measured on an oscilloscope of a very famous device called the Steorn device from Orbo Electromagnetics. You can read all about it. There's hundreds of websites. Okay, and here is the principle, and they don't know it, but I feel sure, once I saw that plot of their voltage wave, of why that thing works. Implosive collapse. So if you can get a heterodyne cascade outputting from two oscillators that does this, the charge distribution is perfected. I can tell you when we output that heterodyne, those two frequencies, to piezoelectric speakers, that you could walk way down the driveway and still hear it. It was the perfect echo. I was there. I tested that circuit. I can tell you this is perfected distribution of charge, actually, implosive collapse. So I'm just giving you some clues, some background to what we plan to do with this. So as you know, here in Melbourne, with the help of Ian and Serge here, we're reconfiguring various devices. This is the Anton cell. I brought in from the Swiss-German group, and they claim already radical efficiencies, and we're hoping to increase that using these key frequency signatures and these charge distribution devices. Although right now, our professor friend is telling us more that a lot of this is accomplished effectively by what's called a plasmon wave, and that even the mechanical interference alone can achieve that implosive collapse in water. That's a bit of the advanced science here. But I'm just telling you that
these concepts are translating very practically into technology that can solve problems, because we know that water is burnable. And the water vapor that comes off, the hydrogen gas, exists in various states of plasma, which is magic. I'll just give you a final example. We're running out of time here. We're going to say good day. But just a final example. You know, there's a group called Magna Gas by Santilli in Florida. And then there's Brown's Gas, which is, these are various forms of hydrogen.